Joining us now is Chris Johnson from MassinSports.com. And Chris, we welcome you to the show. And I know you've covered Max Scherzer in his first year with the Nationals. What do you think stood out most about that first half, and what was the drop-off during the second half?
Well, just to start with the second half, I think Mel's exactly right. I think that when you look at what he did in the first half there, he was so dominant. On the arguably, you know, if the Cy Young Award's given out mid-season there, Max Scherzer most likely wins it. He would have started the National League likely in the All-Star game had he not pitched on that Sunday, the day before the last day of the break there against the Orioles there. He was the most dominant pitcher. Obviously, Arrieta was the best in the second half of the season and one of the best second halves in the history of the game that he showed. And certainly Kershaw and Greinke were dominant as well. But for that first half, Scherzer was so good. And I think maybe a little bit of the reason that you saw that drop-off in August and a little bit into September there was because he had pitched so deep into so many games in that first half of the season. I mean, he had taken so many games, so many no-hitters and perfect games deep into some of those contests. The first game of the season, opening day, he takes a no-hitter into the sixth against the Mets, and if not for an error that Ian Desmond sort of caused a tailspin of an inning there. Who knows? He may have started the season and ended the season with no hitters last year. It was dominant for so much of the year, and that's what made what Mel was just talking about, that six or seven stretch of starts there, so baffling because really during that time he was so pedestrian. He was one of the worst pitchers in the game, and the unfortunate part about it was, guys, that's when they needed him most. I mean, that was during the time when they were really battling with the Mets. They had gone out west, and they were really struggling, and they needed their ace, and he wasn't available for them then.
Chris, do you think, I know he tried everything under the sun to get his command back. Do you think he tried too hard? Do you think he was overthinking it? I mean, he was telling people that he was throwing 1,000 tennis balls against the wall in between starts. I don't know if that was just figuratively or what, but the point is, describe a little bit about what was going on when he was trying to fix his command issues.
I think so. I mean, I think that, you know this guy's such an intense competitor. You see the way he is on the mound, and this guy really takes it seriously every single day. And this guy's one of the first guys to the ballpark. You'll see him. If you show up around Half Street down at Nats Ballpark, you'll see him running around. He's down in the mall area jogging every day early, and you know, around lunchtime. You go on the road, you'll see this guy running around opposing cities here. I mean, this is a guy who takes it very seriously day in and day out throughout the season, and an overly competitive guy. So I think when he hit that stretch there, no question that he was pressing there, and I think that it took him to sort of slip out of that. We saw the way that he ended up finishing the season with an incredible start against the Reds, where again he took a no-hitter into the eighth, and then of course the way he finished it against the Mets the last game of the year with 9 straight strikeouts to finish and 17 overall, and just an incredible performance. It could have been a perfect game if not for Escobar's throwing error there. So I think that shows the real true grit that this guy has, that he went through that stretch, and a lot of pitchers would have worn down and sort of just faded away throughout the season. We've seen it happen to so many guys before, but this guy figured it out, and he really grinded through the end of the season and finished on the highest of notes.
Yeah, Chris, I think so. Those points that you just talked about are showing why Max Scherzer is going to – it has been – and will continue to be so valuable to this organization. When you looked at the second half, you thought, oh boy, he wasn't anywhere near as good. Well, he still wasn't awful. You're talking about an ERA of 3.7. Those guys are getting $18 million a year for that. And that was his bad run, his bad stretch during a year when the first half would have been something that he could duplicate, might have been something historic. So are we kind of nitpicking a little bit, even though we all know, yeah, he wasn't good in some particular starts when the club and the rotation in particular needed him?
Yeah, I think that's really the issue, Dave, is that it was just after you had seen what he had done through the first 4 months of the season, and all of a sudden, you know, they hit this right after the All-Star break stretch here where they really start to battle with the Mets, which caught them there, and it was like, okay, this is the time when you turn to your stopper. This is the time when you need Scherzer to rise to the top, and that was his lowest point of the season. So I think that that's why it's emphasized so much there that he struggled during that stretch. Plus, it's just that the way it happened as well. Like Mel said earlier, it's not as if he was really struggling with control issues where he couldn't find the plate. It was more his command, where he couldn't hit his spots like he was hitting so well for much of the season. And when he missed, it wasn't walks. It was the ball leaving the ballpark. And at the second highest rate ever in his career, and at 9 more homers than the previous 2 seasons. So in each of the previous 2 seasons. So I think that was the part that was just, you know, such a head scratcher for people, was, you know, wow, how did this guy slip so much during that one stretch? But you're right. Overall, when you look at the entire body of the second half of the season, certainly because of the way that he rebounded there in the last 2 starts, it was still, you know, excellent. But you do look back at, like, that start and what sort of caused all that controversy between Jonathan Papelbon and Bryce Harper. That came out of that Orioles game that Max Scherzer started, and it was based off of that 3-run homer, that massive bomb that Manny Machado hit off of Scherzer late in that game, and that's obviously what started everything, with Papelbon going after Machado, and then the rebound from what Harper said and all of that. So it's all Scherzer sort of involved in all of that.
What do you think Max Scherzer thinks about the Bryce Harper Papelbon situation? I think he's a leader in the clubhouse. Do you think it's beyond? Do you think it's beyond any issues in the clubhouse, according to Max Scherzer?
Yeah, I think it is in terms of Max Scherzer. I mean, I will say this: Max Scherzer and Jonathan Papelbon, by all accounts, from at least from the surface, appeared to have a very solid relationship once Jonathan Papelbon showed up after the trade deadline there. And you know, these are veteran guys. Papelbon got along with a lot of the veterans there, as you said. Scherzer was a leader in the clubhouse. But Scherzer also had developed a real solid relationship with Harper early on there, and Bryce credited him a number of times there with teaching him how to approach pitchers and that sort of thing. So I think Scherzer is one of those guys that you look to as extremely instrumental in getting rid of this whole idea that there's clubhouse disruption, especially early on. Like, right away, I wouldn't be surprised to hear him come out at the start of spring training and really say, hey, there's no issue here. There's a lot of guys competing. We've heard him say a little bit already that, look, the season was tough. We just got knocked out of the playoffs. Things were down. There's some highly competitive guys in the clubhouse. We know how competitive both those guys are, Papelbon and Harper. And I look at Scherzer as a guy who's really someone that the fans, the media, will pay attention to when he says, hey, there's no issue here, and anything that there might be, I'm going to be one of the guys to make sure that it's squashed quickly. And I don't think he has any issue with Jonathan Papelbon at all, and I think he'll be one of the guys to make sure that none of the other players in that clubhouse do either.
Well, Chris, as always, we enjoyed chatting with you. Enjoy the information. Appreciate that. And look forward to chatting with you in the not-too-distant future. And, of course, reading everything you put on massinsports.com.
Thanks, guys.
All right, Chris Johnson, covering the Nationals on a daily basis for massinsports.com.